Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Brazil Supreme Court rules Judge Sergio Moro was biased in cases against Lula. Palestinian man launches hunger strike against medical neglect in Israeli prison. Students join teachers in protest against contractualization in Morocco. And in our video section, we take a look at the current crisis in Turkey and the targeting of progressive voices. Brazil's Supreme Court has confirmed misconduct by former Judge Sergio Moro in the cases against former President Lula da Silva. The second panel of the Federal Supreme Court announced the verdict on March 23rd with a majority vote of 3-2. The ruling comes weeks after the criminal convictions against Lula were annulled. He had been prosecuted on charges of alleged corruption following the Operation Car Wash investigation. Monday's ruling was issued after Judge Carmen Lúcia changed her vote on a petition of habeas corpus filed by Lula's defense. She had previously voted against the petition when it was first filed in 2018. As reported by Brazil de Fato, Lúcia stated that the evidence presented since then indicated, to quote, the infringement of the impartiality of the judge. She cited irregularities in the summoning process and the illegal wiretapping of Lula's phones and those of his family members and lawyers. She also pointed to the leaking of the sealed testimony of then Finance Minister Antonio Palocci to the media. A crucial part of the allegations of misconduct has been the revelations made during Operation Spoofing and other leaks by hackers. The files, which were leaked in 2019, showed conversations between Judge Sergio Moro and the lead prosecutor in Lula's case, Delta Ndala Nol. As reported by The Intercept, Moro was found offering advice to the prosecution and giving tips for the investigation. However, Judge Cássio Nunes Marques argued on Tuesday that this evidence was inadmissible because it was, quote, a product of crime. He was one of the two judges who voted against the allegations of judicial bias and partiality made against Moro. A Palestinian man imprisoned in Israel has launched a hunger strike against medical neglect and delays in treatment. 43-year-old Maher Abu Rayan is currently serving a 25-year sentence in an Israeli prison. He has been suffering from problems in his lungs and he has had to get multiple procedures in the past. Originally from the city of Hebron in the occupied West Bank, Rayan was arrested by Israeli authorities in 2003. His arrest was carried out in a brutal manner, with soldiers also breaking his nose. However, a surgery to fix his nose only took place over a decade later in 2015. He had to undergo a procedure again after he was diagnosed with excess fluid in his lungs in 2018. However, as reported by the Palestine Information Center, he requires a special treatment and has developed a sinus problem. He needs surgery for which he has been waiting for over 2 years. According to the Palestine Prisoners Club, the Israeli Prison Service has claimed that Rayan signed an affidavit refusing the surgery. However, the club has pointed out that he has filed several lawsuits against his claim over the past 2 years. He has also launched several protest actions over the past few years. Rayan's case highlights the brutal treatment faced by Palestinians being imprisoned and detained in Israel. Rights group Adamir has previously also accused Israel of having a policy of deliberate medical negligence. It was estimated in 2020 that 700 Palestinians being held in jails were sick. Thousands of students held marches across Morocco in solidarity with teachers protesting against contractualization. Marches were held on March 22nd and 23rd following the announcement of a 3-day strike by the National Coordination of Forcibly Contracted Teachers. The call to strike was issued following the brutal repression of teachers' protests on March 15th. Police had used COVID-19 restrictions as an excuse to break up the protests while also deploying heavy force. Several teachers were arrested and some sustained injuries. Contractual teachers have been demanding their integration into the public sector since 2019, when they also held a strike for weeks. The Ministries of Finance and Education decided to hire teachers on contract starting in 2016. More than 55,000 such teachers have been hired so far. The teachers claim that they are forced to sign the contracts because there are no other jobs available. They are faced with bad working conditions, including salaries as low as $500 to $540 a month. They are given even fewer post-retirement benefits and are also denied the right to strike. The National Union for Education has also called for a strike in solidarity with the teachers. Protesters are set to gather across regional academies on March 24th to protest the use of force against teachers and to support their demands. For a final story, we go to Turkey, where the chief prosecutor recently filed an indictment to disband the People's Democratic Party, or HDP. The left-wing and pro-Kurdish party has been accused of having links to the banned Kurdish Workers' Party, or PKK. The attacks against the HDP have led many to to condemn President Recep Tayyip Erdogan for enacting an increasingly authoritarian agenda. Here is Ertuğrul Köksu from the SDP to talk more about the crisis in Turkey and the targeting of progressive voices.
Yeah, we can speak about a permanent crisis that Turkey is passing through. There are very short instances of a kind of a equilibrium or stabilization in the modern Turkish history of the last 50 years, as far as I know. The remaining is a permanent crisis. This stems from two points. One of them is between the state and society. Turkish state does not fit Turkish society. Ethnic, multi-class, multi-gender, multinational, multi-everything society inherited from the former Ottoman Empire. But the government or the state is either a single party state of the Turkish nationalists or a single party state of the Islamists. So this produces and reproduces crisis. It's the second economic crisis, and which is now aggravated by the COVID-19 crisis that the Turkish government cannot handle. Now, all these superimposed and creating a lot of burdens for the Tayyip Erdogan regime to exist, because the country is very deeply polarized, 50% against 50%, and HDP is in the middle. Whichever side HDP tends, this side is going to win. And HDP is now tending for the last 20 years with the opposition. Indeed, we call ourselves as the third pole, not belonging to either camps of the polarization, but the situation of a crisis which pushes Tayyip Erdogan to progress in the direction of establishing a fascist dictatorship. HDP is now seeking to set up a broad democratic front, including all anti-presidential forces in Turkey. Therefore, this makes HDP the most important figure in this sense, in terms of a political lineup of forces. And the other side of the picture is that HDP is based on the democratic momentum produced by the Kurdish liberation struggle. This is a challenge both for the nation state and also for the single party state, which is based on Turkish Islamism. Therefore, HDP is the first, although it's the third power in Turkey, it is the first power to be eradicated by the Tayyip Erdogan regime. Therefore, HDP comprises everything that the ruling class, the ruling elite, the ruling party is hating and looking to annihilate. It's a women's party, it's a Kurdish party, it's a workers' party, it's an intellectual party, it's the party of the others, and it's the party of Kurds and Alawites. All elements which have been excluded from the official society by either the Islamist elite or the Turkish elite. Therefore, this is why HDP is that heavily targeted, and why the crisis is revolving around annihilating HDP.
And that is all we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website, peoplesdispatch.org. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.